between the leader and the led. The leader and the led. And this is an African poem that is written by the poet, who we can also refer to as the author, meaning he is the writer, and he's called Ney Osunda. Ney Osunda, by nationality, is a Nigerian. When it comes to the gender, or the type, or what we have here as category, this poem, the leader in the letter, is a fable. And a fable is a story, all right, that has its characters as animals. So you see, in the leader and the led, the characters we see in this particular poem are all animals. And that's why it falls in the category of a fable. Then we have the denotation. All right, the denotation. What is the expectation? What is the outcome? What has the poet implored for the consumption of the society? It has to do with the quest for leadership in the animal kingdom. So, this one quest has to do with the desire, the anxiety for which an animal wants to become a leader in the animal kingdom. And when it comes to the point of view in literature has to do with the opinion being expressed by someone as to how things happen. It comes to us in the third person. So it means this story has not, or this poem has not come to us by the first person or the second person, but it has come to us by the third person, and that will be by the point of view. Then we talk about the themes. In every literary work, the themes are considered as the central ideas. Alright? The central ideas. For every story, there is a central idea that the writer wants the audience to know. And so in this poem, the themes are leadership. One, leadership. Alright? Leadership is a problem. Leadership is a problem. That because every animal in this particular kingdom wants to be a leader over the rest of the animals. So we see leadership as the first thing. The second thing is nature. You know, nature is that inborn tendency being placed in every living thing. And if that inborn tendency is not cultivated, you will always want to lord it over other people as to how you think and how you want things to be done without consulting others. So every living thing, especially humans, that got the nature of God giving tendency as to how we should think, how we should do things, we should also do things in agreement, in consonance and consultation with others, and that way we allow our nature to always rule us. If that happens, we become very much undemocratic. We also see this in this particular point. Imperfection. Leadership, because of nature, leadership is a problem in this kingdom that leads to imperfection. Meaning every animal in this particular point has got some hiccups, has got some, you know, flaws. There is no 100% animal that will take leadership responsibility in this kingdom without people, you know, criticizing him. Every animal in this particular point suffers imperfection. Let me just give an example of imperfection on one of the animals, beginning with the man who is believed to be the king of the jungle, lion. Yeah, lion will make a good leader, But again, he sees himself as a king. And so when it comes to going against other animals, he wouldn't have to ask any other question. And that's a problem. That is one of his areas of imperfection. So for this reason, animals could not, you know, have voted into what exactly he wanted. Then when we talk about leadership, nature and imperfection, it leads to imbalance. Alright? Because imperfection is taking place, nature uncultivated, which may cause others to lord over others, is taking place, and leadership, which is always criticized, leads us into what? Imbalance, or being imbalanced. In this particular kingdom, there is nothing now absolutely that is not balanced. Everything is going etter scatter. Because every animal who's supposed to be a leader has got some problems with the subjects. So there is, you know, a form of imbalance. Alright? Then we talk about the structure, the build up, the makeup. And when we talk about, especially when in literature, there are few terminologies that I want us to understand. We talk about meters, we talk about rhythms, we talk about rhymes, we talk about verses, and of course, stanzas. Not far from, you know, poems. So in other words, when we talk about poem, we are talking about meters, we are talking about verses, we are talking about rhymes, we are talking about rhythm, and of course, stanza makes no difference. So, when we talk about structure, a makeup of this poem, it has to do with 12 stanzas. Then the poetic devices, meaning the literary terminologies that have been employed by Lee Osunda. Number one, we see antithesis as we read through the poem. We see simile, the comparison of two unlike things, using us and let. And of course, we see alliteration, where we see consonant or words of consonant, you know, being repeatedly, you know, or portrayed in some senses. Now, of course, we come to diction. Diction has to do with how one speaks. How one speaks. And so the diction employed by the writer or the author or the poet by way of the new sense of the English grammar and composition is very simple. The diction of this particular poem is very simple, meaning anyone can read with comprehension and even analysis that will be understood. We'll talk about tune and the mood. Now, when we talk about tune, let's give a little breakdown about the word tune. I'm sure most of us may be making sense with this word tune, but tune has got to do with how, for the simplest definition, how something sounds. That's the tune. How something sounds. If someone spoke to another person, how that person sounds to the hearer or to the audience. Is the tune harsh? Is the tune loud? Is the tune moderate? Is the tune such as will be able to create sadness or joy? And so, tune and mood, you know, of this particular poem, the tune here, I would say, is a sad one. The tune is a sad one. Meaning, there is leadership crisis. No one can be trusted to lead us because every leader who's supposed to be, you know, elected or voted has got some problem. And when society is really in such, on such a tune, it becomes a problem. There will be no understanding. And of course, the mood. As you read through the story, you're going to read with the feeling in you that there is rivalry. The word mood has to do with the feeling that is being created in the middle by the writer. And so the mood here has to do with rivalry. And we know when rivalry comes about, people are going against one another. It's not a good sign. It is not a good thing to hear. It brings sadness to the subject. It brings sadness. It brings sorrow. Rivalry brings sorrow. no understanding. Everyone is doing his or her own thing. And it brings sorrow and sadness to the surface. When rivalry comes about, there will be unrest. And when unrest comes about, in fact, the word rivalry and unrest, as well as disagreement, which are the tone and mood of this particular poem, the first word we have about play with here is disagreement. When disagreement comes about, there will be rivalry. And when rivalry is introduced, it leads to our unrest. So when it comes to the tune and the mood of this poem, the lead up and the leg written by the poet named Osuna, this is just the analysis that we have. And I'm sure through this analysis, the whole content, that is the plot summary of this poem, is being portrayed.